Welcome everybody in this week's seminar. Today we have a pleasure to have Zuzanna Gavrilova from Hebrew University in Jerusalem. Zuzanna is currently a PhD student of Dorit Aharonov there in Jerusalem. And Zuzanna specializes in quantum causal structures, quantum computation, a bit mathematical physics. Let's say this is her area of expertise, and today she'll be telling us about some nice results she obtained recently. Some no-go theorems about being able to generate controlled unitary operations for arbitrary unitaries. So great, thanks for joining us, Zuzanna. The screen is yours.
Okay, so thank you very much for the opportunity to speak here at your seminar. So I'm going to talk about the impossibility of a natural task in the quantum circuit model. So at some point I got interested in this very simple question. Is it possible to implement controlled U given a unitary U? And surprisingly, it turns out it's impossible. And also proving this required a new method, which I think is quite delightful. And at least I learned some nice math on the way. So the nice math is algebraic topology. And what is delightful is actually that it's really just the basics of algebraic topology that we will need. So probably the most important question in quantum information is to show separation or advantage of quantum computation over classical computation. But it is difficult to prove that some task is hard for a classical circuit. So for this, we help ourselves with the oracle model. So we have some classical oracle that takes in an n-bit input and outputs a bit. And we are asked to compute some binary property of this oracle, which here I call T of O. And a quantum circuit that makes queries tries to compute this property by making queries to the oracle and interlacing the queries with some fixed computation, VI. And in the entire talk, I will be only interested in a query complexity of the quantum circuit. So how many queries it makes or what is the capital N. So I don't care about the complexity of the fixed unitaries here. And at the end of the circuit, there is a binary measurement which should yield the answer to the or the property of the oracle that we want to compute. And so note that the circuit is quantum, the oracle is classical, so we need to make the oracle also reversible or quantum unitary, and this is the usual formula that this is done. And an example in this setting is Grover's search. So the property of the oracle that we are asking in the Grover search is, does there exist an input on which the oracle outputs one? And this can be also formulated as a Boolean formula, as an OR of all the possible outputs of the oracle. And there are 2 to the n possible outputs, but Grover has shown that for a quantum circuit, it is enough to make square root of 2 to the n queries to the oracle. And this is optimal by Bernstein, Brassard, Vazirani. But I am interested in another way to prove that we cannot do better or n cannot be lower than square root of 2 to the n. And this is the polynomial method. And I want to emphasize the polynomial method because I'm going to compare to it later. So we can also look at the T of O as a polynomial function of the possible outputs of the oracle. And in this case, it's a polynomial of degree 2 to the n of 2 to the n variables. But there might be polynomials of a lower degree that still can approximate this function. So we are looking for a polynomial of the lowest possible degree that can still approximate T of O. And the degree of this polynomial we call the approximate degree of T. And actually, what polynomial method tells us, it gives us a lower bound on the number of queries in a quantum circuit. It's lower bounded by this approximate degree. And then in the special case of the function OR, this degree is square root of 2 to the n. So to summarize, I said that Oracle model is useful to prove limitations of a computational model, of classical computation as well as quantum computation. But actually in this example, I talked about limitations of quantum computation. So this polynomial method gives us a limitation on quantum computation. And what we get from this is that exponential quantum speedup in unstructured search is impossible. So we can get quadratic speedup at most. And now we are going to extend the model that I described in the previous slide. So recall that we had the quantum circuit, we had classical oracle drawn from a discrete set of possible oracles. And we are trying to compute some binary function about the oracle. And we can extend this to have a quantum oracle, which is drawn from a continuum of all the oracles of a given dimension. And moreover, we can also not ask about a binary property, but instead we can ask to have a quantum output of the T function, namely to implement a linear operator. And note that I slipped in this measurement. So we have a binary success fail measurement. And by putting here the projection onto success, I am saying that I am only interested to implement T of U in the case that we get the success outcome. And then our natural task is to, given a unitary U, implement controlled U. And the result is that this task is impossible. And I will discuss this task extensively in a bit. I will also explain why I put a tilde here. But here I just would like to emphasize that we are showing an impossibility of a task that has a quantum input, quantum output. And also I would like to argue that showing an impossibility in quantum circuit is interesting. Limitations of quantum circuit, they can teach us something interesting. For example, they can teach us about computation and they can teach us about quantum mechanics. So for the computation, we already saw the example with the Grover search, which taught us that quantum circuit cannot have exponential speed up over classical circuit in an unstructured search. And for quantum mechanics, so for example, we have no cloning theorem, which is a limitation on quantum mechanics. And there is a lot of work of deriving first principles of quantum mechanics from the no cloning theorem. What is so special about no cloning is that it separates quantum mechanics from classical mechanics, because in classical mechanics, cloning of classical states is possible. So, but there are other tasks that are easy in classical mechanics and their quantum counterparts are impossible in quantum mechanics. So the first line is what I mentioned, cloning or copying. In the rest of the table, I use B for a bit, X for a bit string, P for a program. And the last line, if close, actually its quantum version I call controlled U. So not only is our task quite simple and natural, but it can be seen as the quantum version of a classical task that is easy in a classical circuit. And so this is similar to no cloning, so maybe it could also teach us something interesting about quantum mechanics. So now I want to summarize the result, but first I want to say that we can use the language of superoperators to talk about what quantum circuits can do, or equivalently, we can use the language of operators that act on pure states, on vectors. These two languages are equivalent by the Steinspring dilation, because any superoperator can be expressed as operator on a larger Hilbert space and then partial tracing out. So I will use the operator language in the pictures, so in the circuits. And also note that the way I wrote this task, it's not well-defined. It's ill-defined because so according to this circuit, we can just write V1 times U tensor identity V0. And also I have a condition that Ancilla is initialized, so we can just initialize properly. So we can just write a projector of the Ancilla. And this should be equal to what we want to implement. And now the problem is that if we replace U by minus U, then on the left-hand side, we will get only difference in the global phase, but in the right-hand side, we will get a difference in the relative phase. So to correct this issue, we could, instead of U, we could write here some representative of U, which is the same for all unitaries that only differ from each other by global phase. So I will write that by U tilde. And again, what I mean is that by the tilde operation, U is mapped to U tilde. Also minus U is mapped to U tilde. And also in general, E to the I alpha U is mapped to U tilde, and U tilde differs from the unitary that it came from only by a global phase. So equivalently, we can write it as E to the I phi U. So this would be the U tilde, E to the I phi of U. U is equal to U tilde, where tilde is some taking representative operation. And so our task is well defined if phi obeys this condition. And this question was already asked by Araujo and others, and they proved that such a circuit is impossible. And I am interested in the same control U question, but I want to allow the circuit to make many queries to U and U dagger. So it will look something like this, where sigma I of U, depending on the I, is either U or U dagger. Or in other words, sigma I is either the identity function or the inverse function. And our result, together with Matan Zeidel and Jonathan Tuati, is that this is also impossible. But I want to emphasize some differences from the preceding work. We exclude existence of circuits of this form. And excluding any such A is stronger than the preceding work because A is allowed any number of queries to U and U dagger. But it is also weaker because I have a new condition on A that for all U, the garbage G of U should never be zero. And when I say the garbage should never be zero, That means that the entire implemented operator is never zero, the zero operator. And if you notice the projection onto the success, that translates to the probability of success never being zero. So even for the worst unitary, for the worst oracle, the probability of success is non-zero. So I call this condition that A is worst case. And I needed to impose this condition to be able to prove the many queries impossibility. So if I have all the time...
Sorry, yeah? Susanna, can I ask? So like this no-go is in the circuit model, but does the same result hold also, like, okay, because there is also this formula of quantum combs, so but and then basically this circuit result just implies, because like, is it like that the general combs they have roughly speaking the structure as you sort of
So I will say something about supermaps, but I think by general combs you maybe mean even higher order, which I mean, then we would have to define the task. But I think in this order, it's basically quantum circuit, so yes.
So this is like more or less like the most general, like you have some access to this unknown unitary channel,
yeah.
Or maybe it's inverses sometimes. It's like the most general quantum processing you can do to it, basically.
Yes, so even though here it is in the simple language of operators and not super operators, it doesn't matter. It's general.
Sure. Thanks.
Okay. So if I will have time, I will also explain a technical tool that is related to the controlled U impossibility. Here I recall the two ways in which our result differs from the preceding work, but there is a third difference that makes our result stronger, and that is that we exclude also those algorithms A that approximate the task function. So A is good enough even if it only approximates this function. Recall that inside ed A, we had also this projector onto success. So we are dealing with approximations after post-selection on pi success. And for this, we need a new notion, which I call diamond distance for post-selection setting. Okay, so and also to remind you again, so we are trying to approximate the task function by a quantum circuit. And our main method is actually going to also treat the quantum circuit as a function of the oracle, namely as a continuous function. So seeing quantum circuit as a function is not new. It was done previously. For example, the linear method sees quantum circuit as a linear function. So an example is the control U that was proven by impossibility, that was proven by Araujo and others, where they use linear arguments to show that circuits that make one query to you are impossible. Then there is also the polynomial method, which regards quantum circuit as a polynomial function of the oracle. And it was extensively applied to Boolean functions, like we saw at the beginning, T of O, that are binary, so either 0 or 1. And the polynomial method can exclude quantum circuits that make too few queries, namely fewer than half the approximate degree of t, which we saw. And then our new method, I call the topological method, It regards quantum circuit as a continuous function. But crucially, the oracle or the input to the function must be quantum, and the output of the function must be quantum, so linear operator in the controlled unitary case. And since we only use continuity, this method can exclude any finite number of queries. Okay, and next I would like to say something about the consequences of the impossibility. So here I wanted to tune down what I said previously. So from the impossibility of controlled unitary, we get separations between various models of computation. But with the star here, I mean that actually the separation that we get is a weird kind of separation. The common or the standard types of separation are the first two. Oracle separation is between models that need different number of queries to a classical oracle and to be able to decide some binary function of the oracle. And an example is the Grover algorithm. And quantum oracle separation, there the oracle is quantum, it's a unitary, but still we need to decide a binary function of the oracle. And an example is, for example, I think the first one was Aaronson and Cooperberg. They separated QMA from QCMA using a quantum oracle. And the quantum oracle they use is actually quite simple to the quite similar to the Grover's oracle, because what we need to decide is whether the unitary is the identity or whether there exists a state which is marked by the unitary. So there exists psi such that U psi is marked by minus one. And this is the decision, that this is the task that. So compared to that, our separation is quite weak.
Sorry, Susanna. Mm-hmm. Like, just because people here, some of them are familiar with quantum computation or like with quantum quantum complexity classes, some of them are less. So can you just give a bit of explanation regarding what QMA and QCMA?
QMA and QCMA. Okay.
Actually, I know roughly what QMA is, but QCMA, I...
So in QMA, it's like a quantum version of NP. So we need a witness, which is a quantum witness, to be able to decide whether the string is in the language or it's not in the language. And basically here, the quantum witness would be the psi. So the psi, if somebody gives us non-deterministically psi, then we know whether we have the unitary that gives it minus one or we have identity which gives it plus one. And QCMA, there the witness has to be classical. So everything is the same. The Arthur and Merlin, the prover and the verifier are quantum, but the witness has to be classical. And they actually prove here that that with a classical witness, we cannot decide this in polynomial time. So we cannot decide whether we have a unitary that is identity or a unitary that marks some state, which we don't know what it is. The classical witness should somehow help us find it, but it doesn't really.
Okay, thanks.
Okay. So I want to say that we are doing this weird start separation, where the oracle is quantum, but also the output of the task function is quantum. So we are asked to implement a linear operator, and I would say that like this is the direction of the weaker separations. So this one, it would be nicer to have. Some of the other ones. Okay, so in this sense, the controlled unitary impossibility separates, or not impossibility, but the controlled unitary task separates between models. So already Araujo and others noticed that in linear optics, we only need one query to implement controlled unitary. And the implementation is just using an interferometer with polarizing beam splitters, which send a photon which has control value 0 through 1 path, control value or polarization value, and a photon which has control value 1 through another path. And that way, it implements controlled unitary. And now our result says that in quantum circuit, no number of queries would let us implement controlled unitary. So I think this is already interesting separation, even this kind, because it says that linear optics is in some sense, in this sense, more powerful. And so I think it could motivate trying to find algorithms that are directly in optics or directly in a model that uses indistinguishability of particles, which is what I think matters here. And I want to also say something about another quantum model, which is supermaps. So quantum circuit has an arrow of time. It has causality. And supermaps are just a relaxation of quantum circuit without this causality. So relaxing the causality. So this is actually how I got to be interested in the question of controlled unitary. I was interested in supermaps because this is defying causality is really interesting. And actually, they have an argument in favor of this defying causality, which is the task of quantum switch. Because so quantum switch somehow switches the order of two oracles. And quantum switch is possible in linear optics, which is an argument for it that it's a physical task, but it's impossible in a quantum circuit, and it is possible in supermaps. So this makes it seem like supermaps are the correct extension of quantum circuit in order to capture more physical things. So I think controlled unitary is a similar task, but simpler because it doesn't have any non-causal stuff happening. And it turns out that controlled unitary is not in favor of supermaps because the impossibility that the R proof of impossibility in quantum circuit actually extends quite easily also to an impossibility in supermaps. And I will discuss this in the conclusions.
Can I ask you a question?
Okay, Tomek, go first. Yeah, you were first.
Okay, thank you. Can you maybe elaborate more about what the relaxed causal structure is? Because I don't quite get it.
Sorry.
Like in the definition of supermaps.
Okay. Yeah, so if it's okay, okay. I have a picture at the end of the
Okay, sure, I can wait.
Yeah, I think okay, I think maybe thanks. It will make it more clear. But I mean, you agree that quantum circuit gives partial order to making queries. So yeah, the way I'm making queries in a quantum circuit, immediately it gives it partial order. Supermaps shouldn't do that. Like somehow I don't have ordering of queries in time. And but you will see what it looks like.
Okay, thanks.
So I have a question like about this this third type of separation, so the one that you consider. So I mean, so the task is to implement this this linear operator, and is there like a verification task somewhere here, like how to kind of verify that you've done that, right?
So no, like really, I'm only here talking about the implementing. I mean, if you had a verification task, then you could make it one of the better separations. Yeah, I mean,
okay, yeah, sure. Cool, fine.
Which is maybe possible. Actually, this is one of the open questions. Okay.
Thank you.
So next, I want to discuss another separation between models. It's still the starred one. I just was lazy. But first, recall that our result is that quantum circuit cannot even approximately implement controlled view from U, even if given any number of queries. But this is suspicious because usually any problem you have, if you have exponential amount of resources, you can find some sort of brute force solution or a brute force way to solve it, and which here would be process tomography, because we are given an oracle, and like process tomography is kind of brute force. If we have many enough copies of the oracle, then we can just do process tomography on it, get classical description of the oracle, and then build from scratch a circuit that implements control U. So why doesn't this contradict our impossibility? So actually, I don't know, maybe you see it, but I didn't see this immediately. And we were thinking about this a lot after we got the result, like it was a bit worrying. So there is a resolution. The tomography actually yields a bunch of implemented operators that one of them is chosen in random, and they differ in the relative phase. And then we could ask about this random task instead, and we get a bonus separations that separates between the measurements that quantum circuit is using. So we will get that a measurement with one success outcome is weaker than a measurement with many success outcomes. And I will also explain more about this in the conclusions. Okay.
Excuse me, what was phi in this, in the previous equation? There was phi labeled by X.
Labeled by X, exactly. So I had this entire argument about defining well the task, and here I had to add this phi of U.
Ah, right. Okay, this is this thing. Cool. Thank you. Sorry.
Okay. So next, I want to prove the result. So the operator formulation of the impossibility is the following. There is no continuous homogeneous function A on the d-dimensional unitaries such that this equation holds with some phi and with some gu that is never zero for all unitaries. So the equation actually stands for A doing the task, doing controlled U. And the continuous homogeneous A stands for A being a quantum circuit, or follows from A being a quantum circuit, which I'm going to argue next. So any A that is a quantum circuit looks like this picture. And this picture also, okay. Sorry, I have to say what is homogeneous. So a homogeneous function, a function f is W homogeneous if f of lambda x is equal to lambda to the W times f of x for all the lambda that are scalars. But here we are on the unitaries, so lambdas are of modulo 1, they are on the circle. Okay, so this is homogeneity, and then when I say that A is homogeneous, I mean it is W homogeneous for some W. Okay, and now I want to argue that this is really the case for A that is a quantum circuit. So any A has to come from that is a quantum circuit, it comes from a picture like this, which corresponds also has a corresponding equation. And note that sigma I are either the identity function or the inverse function, both of them being continuous. So, and this is just a multiplication. So A has to be continuous by this equation. And then if we put A of lambda U instead, then if sigma I is identity, we will get lambda out. If it is inverse, we will get lambda to the minus one out. Either way, we will get at the end lambda to some W A of U. Like all the lambdas and lambda to the minus one will collect to some factor like this. So A is also homogeneous. So I hope that I convinced you that any quantum circuit corresponds to A that is continuous and homogeneous. Okay, and so at the beginning, I didn't know that implementing controlled unitary is impossible. So I was actually looking for a circuit that would implement controlled U. And moreover, there is a work, a preceding work, where they found a circuit that implements something very similar, controlled U to the D. And they show a circuit that can do that. And then when I realized that controlled U is impossible, naturally I asked, how about other powers? Control U to the M for some M. So it turns out that controlled U to the M is equally impossible if M is not a multiple of D. So we get a dichotomy in the parameter M, because if M is a multiple of D, we can use the algorithm of Dong and others and apply it as many times as to get M. So now I'm going to prove the impossibility theorem, but first actually I want to directly prove the one with approximations as well. So I will state that one, it's a generalization. So let D not divide M. There is no continuous zero homogeneous function curly A, which is from the unitaries to the superoperators, such that on every input, the output of the superoperator after renormalizing is close to the output of control U to the N, superoperator. And by close, actually, I mean not very close. So even a very sloppy curly A's are excluded. Okay, and here notice the star on the superoperators. So I have some condition on the superoperators that they are completely positive, trace non-increasing, which is just being physical, and trace non-vanishing, which is something that I need in order to for this to be never zero. Okay, and again, the theorem has two parts. One is saying the curly A approximates controlled U, and this part, that curly A is continuous and zero homogeneous, comes from the fact that curly A should correspond to a quantum circuit. And this I again need to show to you, but it only follows by this Steinspring dilation equation, where we make the superoperator curly A from the operators that we had on the previous slide. A on the previous slide was continuous, so curly A is continuous, so that's okay. And A on the previous slide was W homogeneous, so if we stick here lambda U, then we will get lambda to the w here, lambda to the minus w because of the dagger here. So the curly A is going to be zero homogeneous. Like they cancel. Okay. And now we are going to prove this theorem, and we will need this topological lemma for it. So let D be a natural number and M an integer such that there exists a continuous M homogeneous function from the unitaries to the circle. Then M is a multiple of D. An example of when we have continuous M homogeneous function is the determinant. The determinant function takes a unitary and makes it a det of U. And if we put a lambda here, det of lambda U is actually lambda to the dimension. So it's D homogeneous, this function. Okay, but the impossibility that it has to be a multiple of D, this we will see. But first I'm going to prove the theorem assuming the lemma. So I will assume that curly A, where this is true and everything, the curly A of the theorem exists, and I will build from it F. And then the lemma says that actually M is a multiple of D, so I get a contradiction. So this is the how the proof is going to go. So suppose continuous zero homogeneous curly A exists, such that the inequality in the lemma holds, then also this inequality holds. Why? Because there are two steps from here. One is multiplying by an operator whose operator norm is less than one. This is contractive for trace norm. It can only decrease the trace norm. And the second step is taking trace, which is also contractive. So we get this inequality. And now, and note that I only used a specific state here, specific input state. And now I will define a new function, f of u, as the left side. So this is the definition of f of u. Note that because curly A is continuous and this is never zero, f is continuous. Yes. And because this is zero homogeneous, up and down, and here I have u to the m, it's m homogeneous. F is m homogeneous. Okay, so I called this sum function, and this right side I will evaluate. So first note that we can take this zero around, and zero on the control will take down from the controlled u to the m only zero tensor identity. And one on the control will take down from controlled u to the m to dagger one tensor e to the minus I phi of u. We had there this phase. And u to the minus m. The minus is because of the dagger. And also we can immediately multiply it by this u to the m that we have here. So this actually becomes identity. And then I just copy down rho plus and trace. So this is what I got. And then rho plus has plus plus on the control. So with the zero, I get 1/√2. With this plus with the one, it gets 1/√2. So actually this is going to be equal to 1/2 e to the minus I phi of u. So I defined a function on the left side and I evaluated what is on the right side. I get this inequality. And recall again that f was continuous, m homogeneous, and by this inequality, because the inequality is strict, it's never zero. And it's it maps to a scalar because we are just taking trace. So all we need to do is to renormalize f. So let's define a new f prime, which is f of u divided by square root f star, f of u complex conjugate f of u. So f prime is continuous because this is never zero and this is continuous. F prime is m homogeneous because this is zero homogeneous and this is m homogeneous. And since I renormalized it, it is from the unitaries to the circle. So I get the conclusion of the lemma. M is a multiple of D, which proves the theorem. Okay, so next I want to prove the topological lemma. So we will look at the space of unitaries. And we will parameterize paths on them. So by a parameter t from 0 to 1, so this would be the unitary at time 0 and the unitary at time 1. And I will need a notion of homotopy. So two paths that start and at the same point and end at the same point are homotopic if I can continuously deform one to the other. This is what's called homotopy. Okay. So we will look at three paths on the unitaries. So the first path, note that there is a scalar e to the I to pi t, which is just on the complex plane, starting at one and making a single loop. So this unitary is actually looping all of its diagonal entries simultaneously, making one loop with all of the diagonal entries. Okay, the next unitary, so delta goes from 0 to 1. So here we are looking at the time interval that is from j over t to j plus 1 over d. And in this time interval, the jth diagonal entry is making a loop. So on the entire interval where we have t from 0 to 1, this unitary path is looping each of its diagonal elements in sequence. And now I claim to you that u is homotopic to u prime. So looping all of them simultaneously is the same as looping each one of them in sequence. This is not so hard to show, but I won't have time. So, and then the last loop is similarly on this time interval, making one loop on the first coordinate. So in the entire interval, there will be d loops on the coordinate, on the first coordinate. And moreover, each interval like this is identical. So it's actually periodic and it has d periods. And I claim to you that looping sequentially on all the coordinates and looping d times only on the first coordinate is are homotopic. So u prime and u prime prime are homotopic. And by transitivity, then we get that U is homotopic to U prime prime, which is what I wanted. And now we assume the function of the lemma. So it's from the unitaries to the circle. So if we compose F on the unitary paths, we will get paths on the circle, loops on S1 we'll get. And moreover, F is continuous, and that implies that also these two composed paths have to be homotopic. And now we can try to evaluate the first one by just substituting the definition of U of T. So e to the I 2 pi T identity. And now I'm going to use the fact that F is M homogeneous. So then I get e to the I 2 pi M T F of identity. So the blue one is actually a loop that starts at some F of I and then makes M loops on the circle. It's again on S1. So this is M loops. And the second one, I'm going to use the fact that U prime primed is periodic with D periods. So on each interval like this, it looks the same. And then F composed on U primed on each interval like this looks the same on the circle. Say it makes K loops. And we have D intervals like this. So on the entire interval, we will have K times D loops on the circle. So we ended up with different numbers of loops on the circle, but what is special to the circle is that different numbers of loops can never be homotopic to each other. So the only resolution to this homotopy is that M is equal to KD, which proves the theorem, the lemma, sorry. Okay, now I don't know how much more time I have.
Like 15 minutes, 20 minutes, something like that.
Okay, so maybe I will skip some parts of this next section. So I want to say something about the tool for dealing with post-selection and approximations at the same time. Recall that I had two versions of the impossibility. One was in terms of operators, and it was exact. But I could make it also with approximations. I would just use some measure for distance of operators, which would be operator norm. So here I would put a minus, and I will call it the operator distance. The second formulation was in terms of super operators. And we were asking for a curly A that outputs a super operator, then on any input, its output after renormalizing is close to the output of controlled U superoperator. This renormalizing is a little bit of an issue, but note that if I didn't have the renormalization, then what is on the left side is actually a standard distance measure for superoperators that I call trace-induced distance, but I think there are many names to it. But okay, trace-induced distance. And there is even a more standard measure, which is diamond distance, which is the stabilized version of this. But the equation is the same, only the supremum would be over a larger set. So first I want to, and then the objective function would be the same. So first I want to say why I used here some version of trace induced and not the more common diamond distance. So note that this theorem says the following. There doesn't exist a curly A such that this trace induced distance is smaller than 1/2. So equivalently, I could say that for all curly A, the trace induced distance is bigger or equal 1/2. And this is what the theorem says. And then for free, I will get, since diamond distance is larger, I will get a lower bound also on the diamond distance. So I just kept it in this form because it's stronger. The theorem is stronger. But a bound on the diamond distance follows. Okay, but our main issue in this section of the talk is that we do have this renormalization here. So I want to ask about stranger animals, which would be some distances with post-selection that I will just put these hats here. So now this is not crossed out. And I would like to, for example, relate this to the operator distance, but also in general to say something useful about them. Okay. Let me skip this. It says something about the previous work, and let me get straight to the post-selected versions. So here I have the renormalization of the two super operators that I'm comparing, and then I am stabilizing that new version. So what is special about this is that as opposed to the non-post-selected versions, they do not obey some properties. For example, the objective function of the maximization here is not convex. There is a counterexample, but I think it's not so interesting, so I'm not going to go through it. But also the post-selected version of diamond distance is not contractive. And contractivity is very common. We also used it in the proof for the contractivity of trace norm. So even if tau is trace non-increasing, this doesn't hold. And I think the counterexample is quite nice and intuitive. So let's look at the counterexample. So let's choose super operators that all they do is they ignore their input and output some fixed state. And the fixed states are classical. So for example, for the psi, independently of rho, it will always output a matrix which has this probabilistic vector on the diagonal. Okay, and this is a nice example because we can have some intuition for it because we can just draw it in 3D. Okay, so we have one half, one half, one half. So the first vector is here, and the second vector is here, and their distance would be the difference, the pink one. And then the tau, the super operator, let it be just the projector onto the XY plane. So then I end up, after the projection, I end up with these two vectors, which have the same distance, so contractivity would be okay. But the problem is that I am renormalizing here. So actually I have to make them, first I make each one of them norm one, and then I look at the distance. So that's a counterexample. I increased the distance. Okay, and the next property is additivity, which says that if I compose with a new pair, primed pair of super operators, then the new error should be upper bounded by the old, the error on the old pair plus the error on the new pair. And this is actually also, this is also a counterexample to additivity, because we can just choose both of these to be tau, and then this is going to be zero, and we just get the contractivity, which we have a counterexample to. Okay. And then the main work of this technical node is to actually prove some versions of what we saw didn't work, and also to prove this relation between distance of operators and distance of super operators. But I won't go into that. And for all of these proofs, the main tool is some conversion lemma, which converts between the post-selected version and the non-post-selected version of the super operator distances. Okay.
Sorry, Susanna, can I ask, you defined the stabilized version of this post-selected distance. So for distance between trace preserving channels, you can just have like extend the space by identity of the same identity channel on the system of the same dimension. But here, like, can you is it the same or it's
so, actually I proved this. Yes, it's the same, but okay. As far as I know, in the proof for the in the non-post selected, they used convexity of the objective function, uh-huh. But it's possible to go around it and instead use some other trick. And yes.
So in the end, even when you have this funny post-select distance, ancilla of dimension which equals the dimension of the space suffices to maximal distinguishability.
Yeah.
Cool. Thanks.
Okay. And now let me talk about the consequences of the impossibility. Again. So this is again the same table that you saw in the introduction, and I promised that I would to somebody that I would say something more about supermaps. So now I proved to you that this is indeed impossible for any number of queries in quantum circuit, and I owe you the extension to supermaps. So here I have a picture of a supermap. So instead of having some queries in order, that I can put some order in it, in a supermap, it's sort of a tensor network where I have queries and they have no ordering, and all I have is some contraction of all of them by some tensor W into a supermap. And okay, there are some consistency requirements on W to make sure that probabilities sum up to one and so on. But in general, this is what I meant by there not being causality. And we are still asking whether this entire contraction, this entire operator, can implement control U. So we have some global input, global output, and there should be control U implemented to it. And fortunately, and all we need is an equation. So this would be, the curly A again would be the implemented super operator. And here, okay, so the equation is quite complicated. It has Choi-Jamikovsky isomorphism, the queries are also super operators. Everything is Choi-Jamikovsky isomorphism of super operators. But all you need to take away from this is that at the end we get that curly A is still a continuous function of U and zero homogeneous function of U. And note that in my theorem, That's all I said about Curlier. So I argued for a long time that if Curlier represents a quantum circuit, then it is continuous and zero homogeneous. Well, it turns out that if Curlier represents a supermap, then it is also continuous and zero homogeneous. And the same impossibility holds. So that means that supermaps do not cover all physical transformations, provided that we consider control due a physical transformation, which is something debatable. Okay, and and now I want to say something about what I said in the introduction about process tomography. So I recall that we proved that quantum circuit cannot approximate the control function. And then we asked, but what if we just do process tomography of the oracle U, and then based on that continue? And I said that this has two resolutions, the fact, like, how come they don't contradict each other, the impossibility and the idea with process tomography. So first resolution is that process tomography achieves a different task, and second one, that process tomography is not in our model. For the first one, the process tomography actually implements an operator that is randomly chosen from some set of operators that I indexed by this little x. They differ from each other only by the relative phase, and the x is taken and random from some index set of labels capital X, and the capital X is the set of measurement outcomes, success measurement outcomes. And process tomography has many measurement outcomes, but it must have at least two. And so the first difference is that the task here is random. To distinguish the original task from it, I call the original task deterministic. And the second difference is that we must have, the process tomography strategy is inside a model that has at least two measurement outcomes. But in our model, if you recall, we had a bunch of unitaries, and then we had a projector onto success, which just implicitly there was one success outcome. Okay, and now you could ask, but I don't believe you. How come you cannot make the process tomography strategy also into this model where you have only one success outcome? Why cannot you have that the cardinality of this set is just one? Well, so tomography can only access the superoperator. Superoperator is the physical thing. So in this case, we're making tomography of the oracle, so it can access the oracle superoperator, and it approximates it. And by our topological lemma, and also it can be proven directly, there is no continuous map from the superoperator to a unitary to operator, where I used this U tilde as we had at the beginning for this entire U tilde is some representative. So there is no such continuous map. And then you could say, okay, so let's do it discontinuously. But a problem with the discontinuous mapping is that we are actually in a setting where we're doing everything approximately. So process tomography can only approximate the superoperator. It can approximate it as well as you want, depending how many copies of the process you have. So it can be a very small error. But because we have a discontinuity in this map, there will be some unitary at which we are at the discontinuity. And then the error becomes constant on when we move to the operator. Okay, so this is the problem. To summarize it in a table, I proved to you that this impossibility, that there is no, that the deterministic control view is impossible, in the model where you have one success outcome. And the process tomography gives you an algorithm for the task, which is the random task, in the model where you have many success outcomes. And these off-diagonal impossibilities follow from my impossibility, and they sort of follow by definition. So if we define reasonably what it means to have a deterministic model achieve a random task and the vice versa. So if we define it reasonably, then immediately by definition, we get these impossibilities. And then if we look at the random controlled U task, we can see that by this task, we can separate two types of measurements. So the task is possible with the exponential number of queries if we have one type of measurement, and it's impossible if we have the other type of measurement. Okay, and now I just want to say the open questions. So I said that the tomography can do this random controlled U task. It can do it with exponential number of queries because it's a brute force approach. So my question is, maybe there's a smarter algorithm. And I think it's a very nice question because it would make us come up with a smart algorithm that is in this model, which I think is quite new, of many success outcomes. And then this point is about the issue that we are here. I showed only some weird separation, which is about implementing a linear operator. So I'm not very happy with that. It would be much better to have some. So in the lab, you can you always get statistics from measurements. So it would be great to have some difference in statistics or some inequality. Nothing quantum, no implementing quantum operators or anything like that. So the question is, can we convert this controlled U question to something like that? And then the linear optics model comes out quite strong from this talk. So the question is, are there other advantages that the linear optics model has, or in general, models that have indistinguishable particles? Or then are there other advantages of many outcomes? We saw a separation between measurement types. And the question is, does this have any effect on the measurement problem of quantum mechanics? And I think it might, because recall that we saw that many success outcomes are stronger than one success outcome. So it seems like it's important when we have many success outcomes that we register the success outcome, that we remember it. Because if we throw away the classical information about which one we got, then it's equivalent to having just one success outcome. So maybe this could say something interesting about the contribute to the discussion. And the last open question is whether there are other applications of the topological method. And I have another application, which was actually suggested by Michal, which is to making superpositions of states. So there also the topological method can say something. Okay, so thank you for attention.
Many thanks, Susanna, for the great talk. Quite pedagogical. We have quite a few students in the audience, so we had like a thorough discussion of the of your results. It's very good. So we have now some time for questions and comments.
Right. So I didn't want to take time because we had like it's might have been already late, but now we have discussion. So Unfortunately, I think I didn't get this process tomography part. So if you could go back. So could you perhaps like elaborate on what exactly this means? So perhaps operational perspective, like because I process tomography, generally you have some like input process, right? And then you do state preparations and like measurement settings. And so I think I didn't get like how to interpret this, what you wrote here.
Okay.
Yeah.
So maybe underlying what I didn't say, but maybe I meant it implicitly. I don't know if it helps. So the strategy to to make controlled unitary was to do process tomography, get some classical output of it, and then based on the classical output, build a new circuit. So
right.
Yeah.
Yes.
So so the idea is that everything that I just told you is just another classical program that you could make quantum. It would be very complicated quantum circuit, but it would be a quantum circuit. At the end, it would have measurements because you can always postpone measurements to the end.
Yes, right? Yes, sure.
So instead of doing these measurements, the process tomography measurements in the middle, you will do them at the end. But then my argument is that you can never simplify the measurements to be just a binary measurement.
I see. So like operationally, this is kind of one can think about this as some kind of like adaptive protocol with randomness, like in this first picture that you said. Yes, I mean, I understand that you can postpone the measurements at the end, but
The randomness comes from the measurement.
Yes,
there is no randomness to begin with.
Yes.
The randomness is big. Yeah. So in that sense, yes.
Okay. Cool. Fair enough. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Some other questions to Zuzana? Okay, I have one. So in your results, you had this assumption that success probability of implementing the scheme is non-zero always. Like, so do you expect that theorem would still hold even if one drops this assumption, or that that one can circumvent no-go in this way?
So I think the theorem doesn't hold if you drop this assumption.
Uh-huh.
First of
so
all,
it would be possible. Then it would be possible to have such a circuit.
Yeah, I think if you allow some probabilities to go to zero, so one argument for it is, for example, that so here I have many success measurements. I could always just say project onto pi one. And what I would get would be the implementing the correct operator, but sometimes it would be the zero operator. Like this is the so that would already, I don't know. So in that case,
right.
Yeah.
But so in that case, you would need to, but that would be for specific, because like. Thing is, like, if you have something that works very well for a specific you, like, there would be other you's that have, let's say, quite good overlap with your, other inputs that have quite good overlaps with your, let's say, scheme,
right. But with some probability, you would get this one, and so you would get this specific phi one. Which is for the first outcome, right? So if I just project onto pi one, that's what I will get. The only way to understand how this doesn't contradict the impossibility is that there exists U where this is going to be zero. So then remember that there is this tensor sum garbage, and that garbage is going to be zero.
So, okay, I mean, okay, thanks. Okay, any other comments, questions to Susanna? Janek?
Yes, I have a question. So as you said, in linear optics, you need just one query, and here in this circuit model, this is impossible. So is there some intuition how to understand this quite striking difference?
At the beginning, when I was, after this result, I thought that my explanation, and I think that's also the explanation in the paper, was that linear optics is not really black box somehow, that you know something about the oracle, namely where it is located, like the physical location of it. And that's why you can sort of build this interferometer. So it's not black box. You know something about the oracle. Now I think that it's not because it's not really black box. It's more that in linear optics, so in quantum circuit, we are limited to composition of gates that are either tensor product or sequential composition, multiplication of the operators. And we don't have this in linear optics. We can also have direct product. I mean, that's a very sort of sloppy explanation, but the model of composing gates is different. These are two different answers, depending like which opinion you take.
Okay, thanks.
Can I just have a little comment, like mathematical one? Because like in the circuit model, it is known that you can create control of some unitary channel, provided you know like one eigenvector and eigenvalue, I believe. Okay, so like you can construct a scheme, like when you have this prior knowledge about your unitary, and in linear optics you can see, I think, the vacuum as such a state. Okay, and like maybe this is like another like complementary perspective about it.
Yeah.
So like within circuit model, you would be able to, if you have a description of such an interferometer in the circuit model, if you have such a description, then you know that in the circuit model, there is some eigenstate of it, and you can pull off the known algorithm.
You know that the vacuum is the plus one eigenstate of U. Yeah, that's another way to say that you can argue that U is not really black box, because, yeah.
Okay. We had quite a long discussion already. Okay, last chance to ask. No, it's good. People are still
sorry,
okay. No, it's cool. So, last chance to ask something to Susanna. So Philip is going to a party, that's great. So
yes, I'm expressing the joy.
Exactly. Okay, let us then thank again Susanna for this nice talk and explaining her results to us. I see you all, I guess, next week.
Thank you.
Thanks. Bye. Thanks, Susanna, once again.